I'm on my way now to see John at Stella Rising in Midtown. Should be another nice conversation with another amazing SEO. I'm just running a little bit late. Hopefully I'll get there in time. The traffic here in New York City has been insane, but I guess I expect that anyway. Hopefully I'll be there very soon. First, it's sponsor time. We all know how important site speed is, not just when it comes to improving your user experience and conversion rates on your website, but a little search engine named Google uses page speed as a ranking factor. That is where eZoic comes in, with their standalone site speed accelerator. This tool is guaranteed to improve your site speed, not just for your visitors, but also will give you an 80 plus score on your Google page speed insights. eZoic guarantees it. eZoic also offers a whole suite of publisher tools, not just for site speed, but also for ad technology, compliance features, analytics, and so much more. So check them out at www.ezoic.com. Thanks, John, for having me here. I appreciate it.
Well, thank you very much for coming.
We're in the Stella Rising office. You can see the sign behind me. Really cool office here. And I just did an interview just around the corner, which I'll link to in the ending of this video. So watch the whole video, and the person you see in that last clip will be literally across the street watching us do this other interview, which you were doing at that interview I was showing you. Yeah. Any events, could you please tell everybody who you are?
Sure, so my name is John Morabito. I'm the director of SEO here at Stella Rising. Been with the agency, I'm coming up on my fifth year now. And we primarily focus on emerging and rising star brands that are within the fashion, beauty, retail, e-commerce space. Our sort of legacy clients range a really broad gamut, so it's not just beauty stuff, but yeah, that's kind of like what we do.
And you've been in the SEO industry, I think you told me before we started this, since about 2014 when you joined like some type of company, is that correct?
Yeah, so I mean, I started here in 2014. Okay. We were formerly known as Flying Point Digital at that point, and then we merged sort of with Women's Marketing, who is our former parent company, and now we're one big happy family under the Stella Rising umbrella.
So in 2012, you were doing web design.
Yeah. So basically that all started where I was working for H&B Digital, which is like a small little midtown camera shop here, very sort of old school. And they hired me as a graphic designer to do like flyers, like literally analog, like pass out flyers to people in the street. And I sort of took over the website and doing a little bit of stuff there. And then this was like right about when the camera industry started to crash, or really at that point it was already in a tailspin. And so we started focusing on headphones. And so my boss came over to my desk and was like, do you think you could build a website that was just about all the headphones that we have? And I'm like, sure, that sounds like a good idea. And so I built the website and it was like, do you think you can get people to come to the website and can you market it? And so I started just basically doing whatever I could to get the website ranked, focusing a lot on just the local queries, and did a lot in YouTube and that type of stuff to sort of get things going. And eventually it became a very well-known headphone store, and it's now he's got a great team of people running it who are doing better stuff than I was ever doing in terms of quality. So it's really exciting. And then from there, I came over here to Flying Point Digital. It's a short story, but it's been a lot of different stuff that I've done over the years in terms of search.
So when you first got into, well, I guess when you were first researching how to rank this website better for its keywords,
sure.
You said you focus mostly on local. How do you learn all this stuff? You're like in forums, Googling things.
I mean, honestly, looking back on that time, your stuff was
a source. I wasn't source. Leading you.
No, I'm just, swear to God. Okay. Your stuff was a source of information at the time. Search Engine Watch, like I actually was really lucky to have a boss who was like into this stuff, even right. though he didn't really understand the tactical like implementation and how to do it. He was reading Search Engine Watch every day and he'd be sending me stuff. And so I was learning from Search Engine Watch, Search Engine Land, your site. And at the time, Moz was definitely a big resource for me. So I, like many people, highly encourage like the Moz Beginner's Guide to SEO or any of the Whiteboard Friday stuff for starting out.
I'm just curious, so Flying Point Digital became Stella Rising. Was that an acquisition? Could you talk anything about that?
Yeah. I mean, so it was interesting because Women's Marketing was a sort of traditional print media organization, did not really have digital services. Flying Point Digital was a performance marketing oriented company, right? We didn't do a lot of brand awareness or anything like that. It was digital performance channels. And so within the acquisition, we're sort of like introducing each other to completely different sides of the marketing picture. And I think now it's really interesting because it makes us a much stronger agency as a whole. And it really gives us the ability to kind of think about, you know, like we might talk a little bit about like branded search today, which is something that I'm really interested in. Like, where does that branded search even come from? So like as an SEO, we just like, okay, cool, brand, people are searching our brand.
Right.
But like, there's a lot of stuff that happens before that, that like now we get to be privy to and a part of, and really serve our clients in a much more holistic way. So I think that's one of the exciting things about the acquisition that is, you know, new.
So obviously, you know, like you just said, SEOs think of branded searches as people searching for their brand name.
Right.
So could you tell us a little bit more about your thinking behind branded search and maybe your unique aspect on how you look at it?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I wouldn't say that I have a unique perspective other than I feel like as a whole, and I'm not pointing at anyone in particular, but as a whole, even including myself up to a couple of years ago, wasn't really paying a ton of attention to branded search. I would like maybe occasionally if the client asked for clarification when we're reporting traffic increases, like try to filter it out and say, well, these are the non-branded queries that we've driven, but it wasn't part of our regular reporting process. It wasn't something that we were like studying or tracking any branded keywords generally, because we're just very focused on the non-brand side of things. And so I started to realize when, you know, we're dealing with brands, some of our clients have 200,000, 250,000 monthly searches for their brand name. And that branded search traffic makes up 88% of their total site traffic. And like, yeah, sure, it's really important to be optimizing their site for like jackets and coats and stuff like that. But if you search like brand name backpacks, right, and there's 22 listings in the top 22, only two of which are a live page and the rest are 404s or things that have gone out of stock, mm-hmm. like, that seems like a really good place to spend some time and effort in addition to paying attention to your non-branded queries. So we started looking at that a lot more. I put together kind of what we call our branded search audit, which is a sort of, it's a combination of looking at where your branded search stands. So first off, I think it's really important to just understand like, what is your ratio? Or how much of your traffic comes from brand and how much doesn't? Where is it coming from in terms of geography? What are the trends? Like, is it up year over year? Is it down? And so, and then we start looking at potential issues with branded search.
I know, that's an interesting way to look at it. So you will actually go ahead and search, I guess your auto would be search for the brand name,
yep.
plus their major, I guess, categories or
yes.
products.
Yes, yes.
Break it down.
Yeah.
Can you just look at, I mean, their 404 pages, their 404s and see what happens with that? Or you're just trying to see like how they're ranking in general, maybe an affiliate's ranking higher.
Yeah, no, those are exactly. So once we get, first off, that first part of our audit looks at, and by the way, all this stuff is on a blog post I wrote on Search Engine Watch, and it's step-by-step how to conduct the audit. But one of the first things you want to do is look at what pages are getting the most traffic and what queries are getting the most clicks and impressions. And then you execute searches on those, and what we're finding is exactly what you listed. Maybe it's an affiliate, maybe it's a retail partner ranking above you. So in beauty, we deal a lot with like Sephora ranking above us for a branded term. Mm-hmm. And you can't always win, but you can sometimes beat that. Or maybe it's just like another sort of area I found really fascinating aside from like the backpacks example would be like questions that maybe don't have apparent search volume or don't have a ton of people searching for them, but you know are important to your brand. So like, does such and such have a return policy? Or what is the cancellation policy if I book, you know, an appointment to get my hair blown out or something like that? And then we'll very often see other websites like, you know, shopcoupons.com or something crazy like that, ranking in a featured snippet, answering our question and answering it wrong. And so in that particular case, we discovered that we had the answer to this question. It was just hidden under a tab on a page, and Google isn't very likely to pull that in as a featured snippet if it's hidden behind a tab. And so sometimes the branded search audit leads to some sort of small changes we need to make on the site to surface things like return policy or that type of information easier for searchers to find.
And you would say this type of opportunity is one of those things that is fairly common in the industry?
Yeah, I mean, I would say, do you mean that like a lot of websites would benefit from doing this?
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think even if you're a small brand, so like going back to when I was at the headphone store, we had a huge amount of people searching our brand because of the YouTube videos that I was making at the time. Well, not a huge amount, but for like a local shop to come from nothing to like 500 monthly searches, we were like, oh my God. And so even then looking at like, all right, is our contact information clearly labeled? Is, you know, our hours coming up? Like, could we get our phone number to come up in a featured snippet? These types of things that just like, maybe they're not totally measurable, but they just make your customer's life easier, seem like a good place for us to spend time. time.
Sounds like a little bit also like a mixing in with reputation management and stuff like that, yeah, on some level, because I'm, yeah, sure you stumble on a lot of stuff that isn't good.
Yes, yes.
Does your firm do any of that type of reputation management stuff, or just by consequence of what you're doing anyway?
Well, I mean, we don't do like reputation management in that sense, but yeah, I would say by virtue of what we're trying to do. I mean, if we saw like some ugly results, we're not going to go like, I mean, we've come across some reputation management firms that are doing some kind of shady stuff. So we're not going to go do black hat anything, but like we might try to introduce some positive things into the SERPs there. But generally, I'm not finding like that type of reputation stuff. It'd be more like terrible reviews.
Right.
Right. And so like, all right, now we need to focus on getting, you know, you guys need to focus on reviews, and that comes back to sort of the whole, we're talking to clients about that anyway as it pertains to like EAT.
Right.
But yeah, that's a perfect example.
Interesting. Cool. Well, I do appreciate you having me here.
Yeah,
could you absolutely tell a little bit the audience where they could follow you, find you, maybe on Twitter, on Facebook, or LinkedIn?
Yeah, sure. So I'm on Twitter at John Morabito SEO. And then you can also find us at stellarizing.com, where you can learn more information about our agency or reach out and have us take a look at your website.
Awesome. I appreciate this. Thank you very much.
My pleasure. Thank you.
So that was John from Stella Rising. Awesome discussion about brand and keywords and missed opportunities and potential really great opportunities for you, your firms, your clients. So hopefully you like what you saw. Definitely comment and let me know if you have any similar examples of that as well. Don't forget to hit that like button, subscribe. Thank you.